Hello, my name is Jason Johnson, and thank you for watching my videos, and I hope you find them helpful. Thank you for subscribing to my channel, and if you have any questions or feedback, you can leave a comment below, and I'll get back with you as quick as possible or try to point you in the right direction. This video is going to cover Chapter 6, Part 2 of 2. Chapter 6 is the Windows Configuration Management, and this video is Part 2 of 2. The link to Part 1 will be in the description below, so you can check that out and play that before you play this video so that you can get that part of the information. Just a word of note here on this video, we are not going to be doing the how-to in this video, so we're not going to be going into how to open up Control Panel and working with that in Windows 7 and Windows 8. We're going to be talking about why we're using these. We're going to be talking about what the tools are, and we're going to be talking about what the information and why we use them and in what context we use them, but we're not going to do a how-to. So this video is not a how-to. It's just covering the material for the PowerPoint for Chapter 6 on the Cisco NETACAD, the IT Essentials. If I can say that properly. There we go. The Cisco NETACAD IT Essentials, and this is Chapter 6. So let's take a look at 6.2, client-side virtualization. On virtualization, essentially and basically what virtualization is doing is you are putting an operating system on top of an operating system, or you're running an operating system inside of another type of operating system. Some people call it sandboxing. But the purpose of virtual machines or virtualization is to provide staff with critical resources. It reduces computing hosting cost, and it provides access to tools not available on a specific operating system. So, for example, if we're going to do a server and we can put multiple operating systems on that server using either hypervisor on top of the hardware, we can basically say the virtual machine is going to run on top of either another operating system or on top of hardware, and it allows us to have multiple operating systems where we don't have to have, let's say you don't have to have three servers. Say I don't have to put hardware in for three different servers. I can just have one server. I can put a lot of memory, a lot of RAM on there. I can put a lot of hard drive space in there, and then I can provide three separate operating systems. And let's say that I want to have one operating system run Windows, and then I'm running some type of a Windows server. I'm running another operating system that might be running a let's say that we're going to run a web server, and then another one might be doing print services or hard drive backup, or you might want to run a Linux server. And so the virtualization allows us to do that. So when we're looking at these, hypervisor is a virtual machine manager. It's software that manages the VMs on a host machine. Hypervisors allocate physical system resources to each virtual machine as needed. And hypervisors can be a type 1 native or a type 2 hosted. And then you can, you're going to learn more about each one of those versions in the course material. But this is, like I said, this is just an overview on those. When we're talking about virtual machine requirements, all VMs have some basic system requirements. The host machine must have enough resources to meet all the VMs as in its host. So, for example, if you have a server in it and you only have 8 gig of RAM on there, and you're going to need at least 4 gig of RAM, or let's say that you're going to need 8 gig of RAM for that virtual machine, you're not going to have enough resources to run that. You're going to need to really beef that up and maybe like put 64 gig of RAM on there so that you can then have 8 gig of RAM or maybe even 16 gig of RAM for that server, and so that you can allocate that out. But you can't, you cannot allocate all of the systems out because you need some either to you need to have enough that's going to be shared between those resources. VMs are also susceptible to malicious attacks, just like any operating system. So just because you're using a virtual machine doesn't mean you're protecting yourself in any extra way. You still have those same vulnerabilities. So each operating system still has to have those things in place that are going to secure it. You need to be doing the patching system. You need to have, if you're doing some type of firewall in there or some type of ports and things like that that are going to be closed off, you still need to do your security layers on each operating system as you work with those. Okay, so that was a quick look at the purpose and requirements of virtualization. Next, we're going to look at some common preventative maintenance techniques for operating systems, and this is the 6.3 of the material. And when we look at preventative maintenance, the preventative maintenance is we're saying that there are things that we need to do before the system breaks. We don't wait for problems to happen, and that's why we call it preventative maintenance. We do things that are hopefully going to keep things from happening. So the plan, we put a plan in place. It includes detailed information about the maintenance of all the computers and the network equipment. It prioritizes mission critical equipment. So you may have a prioritization on a server versus a desktop for a regular user. So that's going to have a higher priority. It includes installing service packs, various updates, disk backups, and disk error checking. So that plan is going to lay out, and it's going to say on server one, we're going to have what type of backup on that server, and we're going to be checking that server how often to see if current service packs are being applied. We're going to be checking that server how often to see if there are errors. We're going to be checking the error files, and we're going to be checking the log files to make sure that different things are running properly. And that's going to be a different priority than, let's say, for a desktop computer that you might check on a less frequent basis to see if you've got service packs and things in place. You might in that plan also say we're going to be cleaning the insides of those computers every year. And what is the plan to do that? You're not going to do them all at the same time. You know, let's say that you're going to do the first five in January, the next five in February, and so on. But that plan is going to contain all that information. Now, on updates are driver information. Driver updates help ensure hardware optimal operation. You typically are not going to go through and be looking for driver updates on systems unless there's something that changes or something that you need to update. Usually, you've got some kind of critical patch that comes out, or they said there's a vulnerability with the hardware or the software, and you need to come out and do a driver update to it. Or let's say that you're installing a new type of hardware or software, and it needs to be updated to meet those. The current hardware and software needs to be updated with the driver or other information to make sure that it works properly with it. Operating system updates address security, performance, and stability issues. Windows has a rolling updates with its system. They usually do, updates. And let me just say it this way. So they may have changed it from the time of this recording of this video, but just check the Microsoft website for the Windows operating systems because they do have a definite plan on how they roll out their updates and their process on how they do that. The firmware updates can enable new features and also improve hardware performance and stability. They don't come off that often, but you want to keep up with those and firmware updates and check those with the manufacturer, especially if you're supporting a server. You want to make sure that you're checking the server manufacturer to see if there are new firmware updates that are going to help with that. The scheduling of tasks. Some preventative tasks can be configured to run on an assigned time, such as backups. Things like that are going to run on a specific time. You can either use the Windows Task Scheduler or the at command, or you're going to use some type of third-party software to install to run the backup or other type of preventative maintenance on your server or your computers. Now, we're going to look at restore points. When you create a restore point on Windows, either Windows 7 or Windows 8, it's going to contain information about the operating system installed, the programs and the registry settings, and it's important to always do a restore point before you make any changes to your computer. So if you're going to install a new program, or you're going to update your drivers, or you're going to change hardware out, you want to make sure that you create a good restore point and make sure that it's make sure it's there, and make sure you can restore from it, so that if you do encounter any problems whatsoever, you can revert back to that. Now, hard drive backups. Backup strategies are crucial. You want to have a good backup strategy for your data. If it's done properly, it's not necessary to back up all the files. You can do incremental. You can do differential, and there's different types of backups that you can run on a Windows system. I'm not going to talk about it here in this video because this is talking about a high level, but you can do some further research on backups on there. And depending upon your type of backup, you want to back up to where we don't really back up to tape drives anymore when you're on a server system. You can get different types of backups, whether you either back up into the cloud or you back up onto maybe an SSD drive array or something along those lines. With Windows 8.1, it includes the file history. And with Windows 7 and Vista, it included the backup and restore. So there are different. They are a little bit different from Windows 8 to Windows 7. So you'll want to research that in the course material as well. Now, the last part we're going to talk about here is the troubleshooting process for operating systems. This is very similar to what we already talked about in the hardware when we're doing our troubleshooting for the help desk, and we go through that process. If you recall previously in our videos, we talked about the troubleshooting process. Well, in the troubleshooting process for operating systems, what we want to do is identify the problem. Obviously, you have to say what's going on. So the first step is troubleshooting, and there is to say, you know, what's going on? You know, are we getting, and I'll give you an example. In my previous video, I talked about the Bluetooth driver not working properly, and the Bluetooth driver was constantly resetting itself. Well, that was identifying the problem. I said, well, I cannot connect my Bluetooth mouse, and so I had to go in and identify what was happening. So a list of open and closed-ended questions is very useful. So I can say, is my mouse working? Why isn't my mouse working? When was the last time it stopped working? And in my case, it was when I unplugged a USB drive. And the USB driver and the hardware control both the USB driver and the Bluetooth driver. And by unplugging that the way it did, it caused some kind of weird thing to happen. And that was a question I asked, when was the last time the mouse worked? And so I can go back and look at that time. I established a theory of probable cause, and I said, okay, what's going on? What happened? In my case, it was a driver for the Bluetooth. But based on those answers, we're going to establish a theory of probable cause. A list of common problems can be useful. My mouse wasn't working, and you know, none of the other Bluetooth system was working. I tested the theory to determine the cause. I tested it to, I did some different troubleshooting steps and said, you know, what's the test on this? Did it work or did it not work? And then I established a plan of action. I installed an updated driver for that Bluetooth, and it resolved the problem and implemented the solution. And you also wanted to document, so we verified, or next. I verify to see if you had full functionality, and we implement a preventative measure. In my case, it was I don't unplug my USB drives anymore or anything at USB unless I make sure that they're properly shut down, because it did cause a problem with my Bluetooth. But you want to perform a full system check, you know, make sure that your backups are in place, preventative measures, make sure those are in place, and then you want to document everything. The actions and the outcomes. If I was working in a help desk situation, I would have created, you know, we would have a wiki, or we'd have a help desk log, which would keep that information there to see if it was happening to multiple users. So with that, you want to, again, I'm going to back up here just so we can cover this again. You want to identify the problem, establish a theory of probable cause, test the theory. You want to then establish a plan of action and resolve the problem, implement the solution, verify the system functionality, and then document your findings. The reason I reiterated that or went back over that again is because you do need to know those steps for the exam and for this course. Now, finally, we're going to look at common problems and solutions. Some operating systems problems are more common than others. A lot of times, and this is a it's not necessarily a joke, but it's a recurring theme, as especially with the Windows systems. And we just say, reboot the system. Have you rebooted? Because sometimes just rebooting a system solves the problems. For example, I've got a mobile phone, a smart device, an Android device, and I was having some issues with it this morning. I rebooted the device, and it works fine now because it just needed to clear its cache. It needed to clear its memory. It just needed a reboot. And sometimes that is all it really takes with an operating system to fix some problems. So some operating system problems are common. Other operating system problems can be caused by hardware or application or configuration issues. It's just a matter of doing that troubleshooting and figuring out what that is. And then a few common OS problems include lockups. Maybe a particular program is being a memory hog, or what we call memory leaks. Maybe you are having a program that uses memory and doesn't give it back to the computer. It doesn't allow the operating system to have that back. It just locks it. It locks it out. Let's say that it uses some RAM, and then the program closes, but the operating system doesn't realize that it has that available use of that RAM back. So sometimes, like I said, just a reboot of the system fixes that. Maybe your keyboard or mouse doesn't respond. If it's a wireless mouse or keyboard, do you have some type of interference? Sometimes the operating system won't start. You know, you have to diagnose that. Is it a hard drive that's going bad? Do you have another file? Did you install new software, a new driver that's causing that? Maybe a service failed to start. A device didn't start when the computer booted up that it did the last time. Maybe it was a print driver that you installed or something along those lines. Computer continually restarts. That's another common one. Without displaying the desktop, that's another one. Or the computer displays a black or blue screen of death. We don't see the blue screen of death very often anymore, but there's a video of years ago with Bill Gates, and they're doing a live video, and he gets a blue screen of death in front of an audience, and it's not hilarious for the person there working with Bill Gates and Microsoft at the time, but it's hilarious. You know, it's kind of funny looking back on it now. And I'll put a link in the description below to that video so you can check that out. Just something interesting that happened with the blue screen of death in history, computing history. And so that's something common that might happen. So what we have done is you just need to figure out what some of those common operating system problems are and just to work with those. Now, with Chapter 6, as we're wrapping this up, we have looked at a number of different things. We've looked at in this video, both in Part 1 and Part 2, that different operating systems are available. You must consider the customer's needs and environment when choosing an operating system. There are certain steps in setting up an operating system. A GUI shows the icons for files, folders, and applications on the computer. And a command line interface uses commands to complete tasks and navigate the file system that you would do inside of a command line interface versus on your GUI. We looked at virtual machines. We looked at preventative maintenance step techniques. And we also looked at some of the tools available for troubleshooting on an operating system. And we looked at some of the common operating system problems with Windows. Okay, so this has been part 2 of 2 for Chapter 6, and it is a two-part video. So the link to part 1 will be in the description below. I hope you have found this video helpful, and I hope you have a great day.